Hello all. Welcome. Thank you for making your time available to listen to my talk. I feel honored and I feel alive because I feel I'm standing in my passion and in my purpose, what I'm called to do. My name is Johan Smit, for those of you that don't know me, all the way from South Africa. I'm a geologist, and hence the title of my talk, Genesis of Geology. So also you will note the pun in there, Genesis, since I'm a Bible believer. Alright, we talked a bit about the modern or the secular theories regarding the origin of the earth. And a lot has been said about that. The modern geology claims that the earth is billions of years old and evolved through a series of natural processes after the Big Bang. So this obviously contradicts the Bible that says God created the heavens and the earth and everything in 6 days. He rested on the seventh day. And if you add up all the genealogies in the Bible, you will get back to an age of about 6,000 years. So is the earth 6,000 years old? Was it created? Or did it evolve spontaneously from a Big Bang many billions of years in the past? So there's the contradiction there when it comes to origins. We're going to talk about geology and the beginning of modern geology. Let's first have a look. What is geology? It's the study of the earth and specifically the structure of the earth, the external structure, the crust of the earth that we can see and we can test and observe, and also the processes that might have led to the formation of that structure, the morphology of the build of the earth that we can see today. That is what geologists do. They look at the form of the earth, the structure, and the processes thereof. Let's first have a look then at what modern secular geology would say. I'll get to the definition of the term secular in a moment. Modern theory says that the earth, or the universe started with the Big Bang about 15 billion years ago. I think, Danny, you said that you gave another figure, but let's give or take a few billion years, 15 billion years, I think that's the figure that I got. But our solar system specifically, where we are located, and also these planets that we've observed just now and going to observe later on, formed about 4.6 billion years. Now, to put it into context, 4.6 billion is 4,600 million years ago. So it's a quite an unthinkable, unfathomable number of years. From the gravitational collapse of a giant interstellar molecular cloud. It all sounds very scientific, and in fact, I don't know if they quite know what it is. So, the theory holds that originally the Earth was in a molten state, very hot, as you can see there. So this is an artist's representation of what the Earth would have looked like. Obviously, no life on Earth, but in this hot, molten state, no water, of course. So when did the water arrive on the planet? Also, when it was initially formed, there was no moon. Now the secular scientists have got to come up with a theory about how the moon formed. You know what they say? Mm-hmm. They say the moon formed after some other planet or big meteorite or whatever struck the Earth. And then a piece of the Earth got flung off and it started to spin in orbit around the Earth. That's how they claim it would have happened. But this all would have happened before there was any water on the Earth, otherwise this theory wouldn't work. So there was this hot molten planet, maybe slightly cool, and then there was this big collision, and a piece of this Earth got flung out and it formed the moon. Now, after that we got water on the Earth, and I didn't put a slide in, but I just thought of it now. I saw it in a documentary program one time, where people theorized, where did the water on the Earth come from? And some guy found a meteorite that came through the atmosphere of the Earth, landed, and they took some thin section of this meteorite and they looked under a microscope, and guess what they found? They found a small water molecule. And all of a sudden the light went on. Ah, now we've got a link between the water on the Earth and the water, the small portion of water in the meteorite. And they said the water came from meteorites. And this guy was standing on the documentary channel on a beach, with a sea in the background, with a piece of meteorite in his hand, and he said, it's quite unthinkable to think that all this came from this. It's in fact what they believe. I kid you not, it's true. And obviously then life, they have to get a different theory in terms of how life evolved. So life, according to evolution theory, started about 3.5 billion years ago with a simple single-cell organisms spontaneously beginning, getting their existence, and then after that the process of evolution into more complex and multicellular organisms, which includes us as humans. So this is where we came from, according to them. We are the product of evolution. Our ancestors were ape men, and something that looks similar to chimpanzees, and you can trace it back to slime and bacteria that supposedly originated in some pond. So we are here at the top of the food chain due to our intelligence. You can see that last guy there is a guy with a cell phone. I don't think it's evolution. Anyways, let's look at what secular means. Secular, the definition according to the dictionary, means not connected to any spiritual or religious matters. So when we talk of scientists in these days and evolutionists per se, it's we refer to them as secular scientists. They don't believe in the spiritual. It's not connected to any religious matters. Where are my arrows? So this is the question. Where is God in this whole picture? Is there a place for him? Now this is a bit of my testimony. You know, I grew up in church. My dad was also a minister in the Dutch Reformed Church back in South Africa. So I was a PK, pastor's kid. And, you know, my foundations were very solid. I learned Genesis, talked about creation, talked about Noah's flood, and everything after that. So when I came to university, after I finished my schooling career, lesson one of geology is the earth is 4.6 billion years old and these are the reasons. And they give me the evidence. So who am I as a matric student to argue with a professor? You know, you're too shy to ask questions and you say, professor, my Bible says this and this and this, because you're scared everybody will laugh at you for what you believe in. So now you keep quiet and you write down what they teach you, and the exam comes and you write down what they taught you in the exam and you get your degree and now you're a geologist. Okay? So, still I'm not sure, did God create or did the earth evolve? So here I'm in the middle, I'm a bit puzzled. And if you were to ask me questions about my convictions after I've studied my degree, I would have been very confused. Now I ask the question, what do I believe and does it matter? This is where the relevance talk comes in. Is it relevant what we believe about that? Many people, even Christians, would say to you, no, it's not relevant. It doesn't matter what we believe. You know, as long as we can survive and we can do our job, it's not relevant. But I know of many people who've lost their faith because of the theory of evolution. Some of them are friends of mine. One is my study leader when I did my my master's degree. So it's very relevant. People lose their faith in God because of this. Look at this quote. This is a quote from a popular physicist, Richard Bozov. He said, Christianity has fought, still fights, and will continue to fight science, I've highlighted the word science there, to the desperate end over evolution, because evolution destroys utterly and finally the very reason Jesus' earthly life was supposedly made necessary. If you destroy Adam and Eve and the original sin, remember, and in the rubble you will find the sorry remains of the Son of God. It's a very powerful statement. If Jesus was not the Redeemer who died for our sins, and this is what evolution means, then Christianity is nothing. So there's a reason why us as Christians have got a job to do to counter the secular theories about where we come from. Okay, my second question, is geology science, right? It's a good question because a lot of geologists would pride themselves in being scientists. I myself like to look at myself as a scientist, we call it earth science, but first of all, it's important to define science. It's defined as the systematic study of the structure and the behavior of the physical and natural world through observation and experiment. Why I've highlighted physical and natural world? Can you study a spirit? No. You cannot observe it with your eyes, your ears, your taste buds. You cannot feel it. So it's impossible for us to gain knowledge of the spiritual realm through the physical means, the senses. This is where the word science comes from. It's derived from the Latin word the senses come from. So we've got the five senses. This is the way that we gather scientific knowledge, okay? Through observation and experiment. So we've got to be able to repeat these experiments. The scientific method, therefore, says it must be observable and it must be measurable. Okay, I need to be able to say which of those fluids is green or red or blue or whatever color it is. I must be able to make observations. And I must be able to measure it. Is it 100 milliliters, 200 milliliters? So there's a measuring component to the scientific method as well. But then if I publish my findings and I say sodium plus chloride would give you table salt, anybody of you must be able to repeat my experiment and get the same results. Do you agree? Mm-hmm. It must be repeatable. If I say if you do this, you pull the string and you release the arrow, you will hit the target like that under these conditions. You repeat the experiment, you should be able to hit the bullseye every single time. So this is the second component of the scientific method. It must be repeatable. But there's a limitation to science, and I've hinted towards that earlier. It says that they are limited to materialism or naturalism. It means that we study the cause and effect in the natural realm. This, the things that we can see and observe and test and repeat. So by default, if we are looking for natural causes to natural effects, we are excluding any supernatural causes to natural effects. Would you agree with me? Okay. This is the limitation of science. And this is an argument that I've had with many friends who turned atheists. No supernatural causes or explanations are allowed. But they are very quick to say, no, I'm open to it, just bring me the evidence. But if I bring them the evidence, let's say this is the evidence that I put on the table, they say, no, but this evidence will be interpreted from a naturalistic point of view. So they are not true to their word. In materialistic science, naturalistic science, it means no spiritual realm, no God would be invoked in any of the explanations. That's the limitation. I've got this picture of a guy inside the box. It means that I'm limited to the dimensions of this box. All my observations and my explanations will be inside this box. So if I don't see any spiritual dimension in this box, does it mean that it does not exist outside the box? No, you cannot say that. But this is the conclusion they come to. Because I cannot observe it here, it means it doesn't exist over there in another dimension. This is the limitation. Right, moving on, materialistic science. This is another quote. It says, our willingness to accept scientific claims that are against common sense, listen to this, is the key to an understanding of the real struggle between science and the supernatural, science and the spiritual dimension. We take the side of science because we have a prior commitment to materialism. Moreover, that materialism is absolute, for we cannot allow a divine foot in the door. Richard Lewontin, who said that. Then I want to have a look at the types of science. First, we get the good science, the operational, experimental science, as we call it. This is stuff that we can repeat in laboratories and we can write articles on, and people can test our results and go and do the same stuff. It happens under controlled conditions. This is the type of science that gave us satellite and cell phones. So it's good science. We can all see that it adds value to our lives. But people use this and equate this science to the next field, which we call historical or origin science. But this is a different set of rules that works here. Types of origin science, we can look at quickly archaeology, where we study we study artifacts that were left behind by previous civilizations. We get paleontology, the study of remains of extinct animals. And then we get the science of geology, which is my field, which is basically, as we said, the study of the earth, the form and the structure, and the processes of the earth. All of these that I mentioned are types of what we would call forensic science. Why do I say that? Because in the field of forensics, we are basically left with evidence that was found on a crime scene that we now have to interpret to fit the best story possible to explain what happened to have left that evidence. And the evidence is explained based on what we believe to have happened there. It's very important to take note of that. I will highlight this just now. So is forensic science, we call it a science, and it is actually a field. You can go and study forensic science at universities. Does this picture look familiar to you guys in Zambia?
Yes.
Does it look familiar? Yes. Who does not recognize these faces? You all recognize these faces. I will explain to you. This is the most famous court case in South African history, at least, and it might have been the most publicized a year or two ago when it happened. It's the murder case of Oscar Pistorius, who shot his girlfriend, Riva Steenkamp, on Valentine's Day a couple of years ago. So what we've got here in this in this courtroom is we've got two attorneys. The one is the prosecuting attorney. On the right is Mr. Harry Nell. They call him the Bulldog. He believes Oscar is guilty. So what he does is he takes all the evidence that was gathered on the crime scene and he builds a story and he tries to impress the judge and to tell her why this guy is guilty. Now Oscar and his team went and they got Barry Roo, the guy on the left, and he is the defense attorney. So now what he does is he takes all the evidence on the crime scene, he builds a story to impress the judge and to tell the judge, by the way, Tokozile Masipa, to tell her why he thinks his client is not guilty. So my question to you now is it possible, and how is it possible, to take the same evidence, Exhibit A, Exhibit B, Exhibit C, whatever, that was found on the crime scene, interpret the evidence, but you get two different conclusions? If it's scientific, should you not be able to get to the same conclusion? Do you understand my point? Okay, this is very important. Why do they get to different conclusions? They study the same evidence, but they come to different conclusions based on different presuppositions. I believe this guy is guilty. No, I believe my client is innocent and I will prove my case. No, I believe he's guilty because of this and this. No, I believe he's innocent because of this and this and this. They've got the same evidence, but they come to different conclusions based on their starting point of belief, their presuppositions. This is what governs historical or origin science. Now, we get the same evidence on the crime scene. These are hominid fossils. Some people interpret it to be our ancestors from which we evolved. Other guys would say, no, these guys just died sometime in the not too distant past based on what we believe. Who's right? Based on our presuppositions, we come to different conclusions. This is important to remember. Okay, I will give you an example. I will show you a picture of an animal. And I want you guys, the first one to recognize the animal must give me the name. Are you ready? One, two, three.
Frog.
And if horse. If I change your perspective?
Horse.
How is it possible to have a frog and a horse? Let me tell you how it's possible. I've just changed the way that you look at the picture. It's the same picture. You want me to show it again? I rest my case, Your Honor. All right, let's go to interpreting evidence. This is very important, the role of presuppositions. This, okay, here's another test for you. This is my crime scene. Who of you recognizes, who of you who are not from America recognizes this crime scene? The Grand Canyon.
Grand Canyon
in America. It's the deepest or biggest canyon on the planet, on continental planet, should I say. Okay, the Grand Canyon, this is my crime scene. Okay, the evidence will be found. I'm quickly going to discuss the evidence and lay it out for you. And I want you guys to tell me what happened here and when it happened without using any presuppositions. Okay, are you ready? We've got a crime scene. It consists of laterally extensive sedimentary layers. Some are sandstone, some are chalk or limestone layers. Others are mudstone. Some contain fossils of some marine animals like nautiloids, some shellfish that lives in the sea. And I'm sure there might be some other fossils in there as well. It's all laterally extensive. But then we've got this canyon that was cut through down into these sedimentary layers. Down at the bottom of the canyon we find the Colorado River. It's running right at the bottom there, but all of the material that used to make up this canyon has now been eroded way down to the ocean. So I want you to tell me what happened here and when did it happen without using any presuppositions. This is our crime scene and I want to explain to you the importance of presuppositions. Any takers? Anyone? Right, thanks, Matt.
Was an earthquake? No. The earth separated?
There was an earthquake and the earth separated.
Mm-hmm.
If the earth separated, won't you just find a crack? What you find here is you find material that was weathered away and eroded away.
Volcano. Yeah.
Volcano happened.
Yeah.
Okay. And when would you say it happened? Can you tell?
No.
Okay. Most people would tell you this happened slowly over millions of years by that river that eroded all this material away.